Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cold Steel by Joe Kassabian, narrated by Kristin James. Chapter 1. The shuttle circled our destination for hours. I watched the large, expansive, circular shape of the station float under us. Its gunmetal gray structure flashed in the solar brilliance each time the sun caught it just the right way. A never-ceasing train of shuttles ran from the station down to the surface of an asteroid, the two tethered together by long metal spikes.
"Next stop, Sassoon Station," came a soothing voice from the overhead sound system.
I reached over and slid the window shade closed.
Excuse me, my lord,
I faintly heard someone say. I saw a flight attendant standing in the aisleway, a large metal cart beside her. She was an attractive middle-aged woman with a tightly pulled back brown bun. She was bowed at the waist in deference. Not to me, but to my family. I had forgotten to take my family crest off of my school uniform before I had left the spaceport on Olympus. Its golden lion shape still sat prominently over my heart. I took my earbuds out so the sounds of the Martian ska music I was listening to didn't drown out what she was trying to tell me. "Hmm?" I asked. She bowed lower.
"The pilot wished for me to extend his apologies to you for taking so long to dock,"
she said, her voice shaking. I guess not many members of the nobility ended up on commercial flights between Sassoon and Mars. I didn't want to be on this flight either. Commercial flights didn't offer stasis treatments, so I had been stuck in this damn uncomfortable seat for the last 3 days. The cabin smelled like stale cigarette smoke mixed with the farts that only subpar economy flight food could produce. The shuttle was packed full of migrant workers from the nearby planets, their unfamiliar musks and strange accents all making their way to the station, hoping to get one of the jobs down in the mines. Each of them eyed me with a mix of hatred, shock, and jealousy when I boarded. I'm sure wherever they were coming from, they wouldn't be allowed to share a cabin with a member of the nobility. On Sassoon, we hardly had the space for such privilege.
"It's not a problem," I smiled at her. "My sister told me traffic has picked up over the last few months, so I suppose it couldn't be helped."
"Have you been away long, my lord?"
4 years, I nodded.
I didn't feel like being trapped in small talk with someone who was seemingly scared just to be near me, but I recognized when I was in too deep.
"My sister had told me the mine has expanded since I've been gone."
She beamed.
"Oh, yes. House Boguni has taken great lengths to bring in workers from around the sector. We can hardly keep up with all of the flights."
I frowned at the mention of the Boguni house, and I think she noticed because she quickly added,
"But of course, none of this would have been possible without your father, the Duke Haduni."
The aisleway of a transit shuttle was not where I wanted to get into a debate regarding inner palace politics that this poor woman probably wouldn't even understand.
"It's fine," I smiled again. "I am glad the people of Sassoon are doing well."
I think she caught on that I wasn't in the mood for chit-chat. She shuffled back to her cart and produced a miniature bottle of Ginny, the regional specialty of the station. From the looks of it, it was an incredibly cheap bottle of the stuff. "Stationer Special," read the label alongside a little picture of a rocket circling around the spoked outline of Sassoon Station. I would have been rude to turn it down, so I accepted it with a slight bow of my head.
"A gift from the pilot. The staff of Sassoon Starways thanks you for choosing us for your travel, my lord."
I didn't want to tell her that I didn't choose this third-rate starway to travel. Nobody with more than a handful of bits to their name would have picked Sassoon Starways. The only people who rode the rusted buckets they called transit shuttles were smugglers and migrant workers.
I just didn't want to wait on Mars for another 3 weeks for my father to send his personal shuttle. The only thing that was worse than this shuttle was Mars. Send the pilot my thanks.
She bowed even lower, straightening up and fished a small molded cup from her cart and handed it to me.
No ice. I shouldn't have been surprised.
The attendant finally pushed her cart down the aisle, leaving me with my 4-bit bottle of Ginny and a room temperature cup. I cracked the cap on the small bottle and decided to drink it straight from the source. The red liquid hit my tongue and burned, so I gutted it down as fast as I could, holding the bottle high so the flight attendant could see me do it.
Nobody was going to accuse House Haduni of being ungrateful on my behalf.
I licked my lips and was forced to retaste the stuff. It tasted like the synth grapes had been steeped in gasoline before it was brewed. I smiled at the attendant and she returned a toothy grin.
We have been cleared for landing at Dock 479. Please return to your seats and prepare for landing, came the voice again.
Finally, I couldn't wait to get off this tub. All around me, passengers pushed by one another to get back to their seats. More than one of them was smoking, while others had the beet red eyes of dust addicts. I handed one of them the remainder of my bottle of Ginny. An old man with a bent back and a face like shoe leather took it from me.
Thank you, my lord. He smiled broadly. Please send my regards to your father.
The man held up the bottle and drank from it.
To his health.
I smiled and tried not to wince when he downed the rest of it in one gulp without so much as a blink from its harshness. Once everyone found their seat, a small light flashed overhead, politely telling us to fasten our seatbelts. The shuttle passed through clouds of transit craft, along with the occasional massive ore freighter that stretched out for miles. They were branded with the logos of countless companies I had never heard of, each owned by one noble house or another, their crests stenciled on at seemingly random intervals. I noticed many of the freighters showed the crest of House Boguni, a black crow with unfolding wings. The organized chaos of the shipping lane was shut away from view as the shuttle was swallowed by the cavernous halls of Sassoon's docking system. All around us, there were thousands of docks just like this one, each having to work in perfect unison with one another to bring in the countless ships that passed through station space every day. It was organized choreography at a scale so great, it took tens of thousands of people working around the clock to make it work. The shuttle shook, and a loud metallic clang could be heard throughout the cabin. Outside, a large arresting claw had grabbed onto the shuttle to hold it in place and was now retracting it back into the station itself, out of the vacuum of the dock. Triple sealed doors opened one at a time, slowly bringing us further and further in. The last door finally hissed and retracted, revealing the disembarkation area. I had assumed flying economy would mean me flying under my father's radar. I really should have known better. The disembarkation area was a drab, mostly run-down space. Its once carpeted flooring had been stomped flat by generations of feet, and its off-white walls were now a sickly yellow from cigarette smoke. Several of the waiting room seats were broken and hadn't been replaced. In the middle of this disrepair was a full squad of 12 fully armed men wearing their palace guard dress uniforms. The dark yellow uniforms were decorated with all kinds of awards, medals, and ribbons. Their ceremonial rifles were laid across their shoulders at port arms, and they stood unmoving.
We have arrived at Sassoon Station. Thank you for traveling Sassoon Starways. We hope to see you again in the future.
The voice bid us farewell.
Not damn likely, I frowned to myself. I waited for the rest of the passengers to get off first. If there was one thing I hated, it was pushy people all jostling for position while trying to get their overstuffed bags from storage. The last thing I needed was to get brained by some miner's carry-on bag.
When they finally cleared out, it was my turn. The flight staff were lined up to greet me, each bowing low as I walked by. I made sure to thank them all individually as I went. When you're the Duke's son, everything you do is part of the bigger political picture. Or at least my father would always insist it was. I always hated that about living on the station. Every interaction was a finely tuned exchange, an act. You could never be sure who hated you and who didn't. I stepped off the shuttle, and the leader of the palace guard rose a foot up and stomped the ground. His means of drawing attention to himself was somewhat muffled by the dingy red carpet.
"His Imperial Lord, Andranik Haduni," the soldier announced.
I could tell by the chevrons on his sleeves that he was a sergeant first class. The palace guard, all in unison, brought their rifles down from their shoulders and thrust them out in salute. Caught up in their presentation, passing civilians bowed low to me as I fought with the wheels of my suitcase across the carpet. From behind the palace guard came a young woman dressed in a long white dress, a shawl draped loosely over her dark hair. Her soft features cracked into a huge, goofy smile when she saw me.
"Ando!" she cried.
The Duke's daughter is supposed to keep herself composed at all times. She even had several attendants whose full-time job it was to make sure she didn't do anything that could be considered unfitting, which I was sure was a lengthy list of activities. Right then, she clearly didn't care as she ran across the disembarkation platform and hugged me. I dropped my bags and caught her.
"Anahit," I smiled. "I didn't expect you to be here."
I hadn't seen my older sister in 4 years, but it felt like it had been much longer. We had made sure to write to one another every day while I was away at school, but it just wasn't the same. Cloistered away in the drudgery of palace life, we were the only people we could vent to and not worry about upsetting some unwritten rule of noble custom or procedure. With me gone, she was forced to survive in the palace political monster on her own.
"And why wouldn't I be?" she huffed. "Bad enough you rode that roach coach here. Did one of the planet-siders give you any parasites I should be wary of?"
She laughed and motioned for one of her attendants, an older woman wearing a pantsuit, to grab my bags. I glanced down at my device.
"Because it's 3 in the morning, Anna," I pointed out. "Don't you have something to be planning? A wedding, perhaps?"
She rolled her eyes. Ever since she was announced as heiress to the throne of Sassoon, the house agency had been sent a deluge of marriage requests from around the empire. My father was old-fashioned, so of course he wanted someone from one of the other prominent families to take his daughter's hand in marriage and strengthen the house's holdings. Unlike many other noble fathers, he respected his daughter enough to allow her to choose who would become her husband. Unfortunately for him, she had so far chosen nobody, much to the chagrin of the entire station government and countless families across the sector.
"A wedding," she scoffed. "You should see some of the suitors they are sending. Absolutely atrocious. Did you know some of these men still live with their parents?"
She stuck out her tongue.
"They even tried to hook me up with that revolting Aaron Baguni."
"The one who had a crush on you all throughout school? The one who used to follow you around like a lost puppy?"
She nodded.
"The very same. He came to the palace in his dumb dress uniform and proposed right at the front door. The poor idiot started crying when I laughed in his face."
"Those Baguni think they should have claim to everything just because of their wealth."
"If only their wealth could buy them a personality, or charm, or looks," she laughed.
We walked through the palace guard and they pivoted on their heels, reshouldered their weapons, and marched in 2 single-file lines at our sides. Eventually, the crowd of civilians abandoned their shows of respect and went about their day, giving the guard a wide berth.
"The flight attendant said traffic has picked up recently."
"Oh,
she rolled her eyes. The Boguni have pressured father to change the laws regarding migrant workers. Some kind of special permit system. It allowed a surge of people to be hired to work in the mines. Of course, it only benefits them. I'm sure you've seen all of their new freighters.
I did. But how are all of these people affording the trip? Sassoon Starways may not exactly be a high-class venture, but their ticket prices are still a bit pricey for your normal planet-sider looking to work in the mine.
That goddess-forsaken Aura Baguni, she hissed. He opened companies in every surrounding settlement offering anyone who could work a job for 6 months and a ticket here. When they get here, of course they learn the cost of the ticket equals to be 6 months of their pay, which the Boguni accountants then deduct from their paychecks. Then they are sent back to wherever they came from. Slavery with extra steps.
Goddess above, Anna. How is that not illegal?
Our procession finally reached the metro station. The Sassoon Metro reached every one of the 12 districts that branched off from the central landing point, each sticking out like the spoke of a wheel, with the central being the hub. Lines of people were waiting for one of the hundreds of metro cars. They would scan their device to pay for their fare and then would be gone in the blink of an eye. A new car would arrive only a few seconds later. There was only one spoke that the metro system wouldn't take them to, the administrative district, home to the nobility as well as the various ministries of government that they ran. The head of the palace guard approached the metro, the crowds parting in front of him. The sergeant scanned a small device that he wore on his wrist, and a moment later, a special metro car arrived. It was generations newer than the rest of the cars. Flawlessly white, it was adorned with the golden eagle of the Emperor of Terra, as well as the lion and crow of the local families. Rather than being controlled by the Ministry of Public Transportation's drone system, it was staffed by human attendants. The door slid open and we made our way inside. Even though the ride would only take a few minutes, the cabin was lined with seats that looked downright luxurious compared to the transit shuttle I had just stepped off from. Metro attendants in starched and pressed uniforms offered me a glass of water, which I took.
Trust me, Ando, Anna continued. I've tried to point that out to father. However, he only sees the influx of money due to the increase of exports.
Surely those exports only benefit the Boguni.
I sipped the water and was thankful to wash the taste of cheap ginny out of my mouth.
They pay their taxes, so father doesn't care.
She sat down heavily on one of the seats. She tried to act normal, but it was obvious the hour and her workload weighed on her.
Say, I thought you always hated palace politics. If you're that interested in law and administration, I'm sure I could change father's mind about your future in the military.
I laughed. As the youngest child of the Haduni Duke, it was tradition for me to become an officer in the Imperial Army. As far back as anyone had bothered to write down, the sons and daughters of Sassoon had served the Emperor on the battlefield. After spending the last 4 years of my life training at Tigranes the Great Armed Forces Preparation Academy, I had no intention of breaking that tradition.
Somehow hearing you complain about nobility and taxes is more than enough to convince me to stay my course.
I smiled.
I'll tell you what, once I am promoted to captain, I'll request to come home and you can give me whatever dreadful ministry job you want.
She covered her mouth and laughed.
How about ambassador to Mars?
I had made no secret of my hatred for the Red Planet during my time at school. It had long been considered the artistic and intellectual capital of the Empire. The only thing I saw was self-important navel-gazing from high-born debutantes. Nobility so far removed from any actual part of society, they were functionally unemployed, nearly alien to their own subjects.
I think I would rather join the Frontier Corps, I joked.
The metro car slowed and came to a stop. The door slid open and the attendants reappeared. They offered another glass of water and bowed as we exited. The administrative district was exactly how I remembered it. The overhead day-night cycle lights were dimmed, owing to the early morning. It was chilly, the air cooled by the constantly churning climate control systems that kept the station habitable. I could taste the purification chemicals from the oxygen scrubbing network that made the environment breathable. Planetsiders thought the smell and taste were overpowering, and it took them time to get used to. For me, it let me know that I was home. The crisp, fresh air of the terraformed Mars never felt right to me. The metro station deposited us at the head of the administration spoke, and we were met with more soldiers, though these were gendarmes, the main law enforcement arm of the Imperial government. They wore brown, drab uniforms, and the look was completed by their utility belts, from which hung a holstered pistol. Unlike the palace guard, these guns weren't ceremonial. They gave a slight nod as we went by. After the reception at the disembarkation area, I assumed I would be walking into more of the same in the place that had been my home for the 18 years prior to me leaving. Instead, the district was mostly empty other than the normal night shift workers going about their duties of maintenance, cleaning, or the like. Anna must have seen me looking around.
Father said he wanted to come, but he's not doing very well, she said, her voice dropping low, almost to a whisper. Our father had been dealing with a terminal illness for several years. It had just really started to take hold before I left for school. Rumors were it was the same illness that claimed our mother when I was younger. The Planetsiders insisted it was because we lived most of our lives on stations, that the human body just wasn't meant for this kind of habitation. I wasn't sure if I believed them, but I did notice many more elderly people on Mars than I ever did on Sassoon.
That bad? I asked.
She nodded.
He can hardly leave the palace these days. He still makes his appearances when he needs to, though.
So it's all on you now, huh?
Unofficially, she added. Though you'll be pleased to know that he is still planning his youngest a party.
She poked me in the ribs, and I groaned.
You've got to be kidding me. A party for what?
A celebration for your commission into the Imperial Army, of course.
But I haven't commissioned into anything yet, Anna. I still have to take the induction exam tomorrow.
She waved me off.
That is a formality, and you know it. Have you ever failed a test in your life?
No, I admitted.
I had always done better in school than she had. Her failure wasn't due to any kind of fault in her intelligence, but rather boredom. Schoolwork never appealed to her. She would sleep through class and then come home and try to debate with our father over civil servant pay raises or some such with such a level of expertise it shocked the people he had actually hired to advise him in such matters. She only graduated with a diploma due to the intervention of the house agency.
I told you, you'll be first in your class and then go on to command some armored regiment like every other child of the Haduni family. Better than those logistics clerks that come from the Boguni. Spineless even in their service to the Empire.
I didn't want to explain to her how spending years studying the complex logistical system of the army probably did a lot of good when they returned to the station and ran their businesses. It would truly benefit my family if I went the same route. But our tradition was riding tanks into war in the name of the Emperor. The skills didn't exactly transfer the same way. Countless members of the Haduni family had been named the Hero of the Empire, had streets named after them on Terra, and Tigranes the Great had even come to my father's coronation. At least, that is what people tell me. All of that glory didn't amount to much when our house agency was running up debt to a rival family just to keep up appearances.
If only I am so lucky, I said quietly.
As we went further into the district, the boulevard was lined on either side with administrative offices, split down the middle between the two families. On one side were the various licensing and ministerial offices that made the station tick. In front of them stood statues of the heroes of the Haduni family, all of them standing triumphantly in their resplendent Imperial Army dress uniforms. Each of them had plaques at their feet, listing their accomplishments. On the other side were the business offices of the Boguni. There was a reason why over the years they had been nicknamed the Boguni Cartel. Dozens of mining, freight, and export businesses, all with different offices, names, and logos, but each owned by members of the same family. It was a facade they could use to make sure if any bits exchanged hands outside of official taxation, it went directly into their pockets. They kept up countless shell companies to give people a mirage of competition. If a family on another planet or station, or goddess forbid, the security services, caught on to the backroom dealing of one company, they would simply close it, change its name, and reopen it. It kept the pipeline open indefinitely and secured the Boguni family as one of the richest noble families in the entire empire. Instead of statues of military heroes, each head of the Boguni family had a simple bust. They wore boring business suits and ties, each of their faces frozen in a way that made them all look like they were trapped in a particularly boring board meeting. Each family had chosen how they wanted to be viewed by the public, and the differences were stark. The Haduni were related to the Tigranes of Terra, though distantly, and wanted to reflect their imperial lineage. The Boguni, rumor had it, had begun life as commoners on Luna, and only through the accumulation of money and power via an export business had they secured a noble peerage through a particularly large bribe. They even eschewed the protection of the Imperial Army's Special Palace Guard Detachment. While the Palace Guard stood outside of our family home, they hired their own security, the so-called Mining Protection Agency, an official-sounding name for what amounted to be a bunch of hired guns kept around to keep migrant workers in line. As we approached the Haduni Palace, I could see the outlines of their black dusters looking out at us from their posts at the Boguni home across the street. In front of the Haduni Palace, yellow-jacketed soldiers stood on either side of the door. Unlike the ones we had met at the metro station, these carried real weapons rather than ceremonial ones. They didn't bow to us, but rather glared, eyeing us up and down. It was clear they recognized Anna, but not me. Soldiers were only posted to various planets and stations for a few years at a time, so there was a good chance none of the current guards were here before I left for school.
"Name," grumbled the soldier on the left. He wasn't asking.
"Roman," groaned Anna. "This is my brother Andranik. He's the Duke's son, for goddess's sake."
"You know the rules, my lady."
Roman eyed her. I had a feeling this was an argument he had frequently with her. He looked back at me and repeated,
"Name?"
"Andranik Haduni," I answered. Roman glanced down at his wrist device. A hologram list projected from it in blue letters in front of his face. He scrolled down a list of approved visitors before finding me. My name glowed and a picture appeared, showing my badly out-of-date high school graduation photo.
"Welcome home, my lord,"
Roman finally said, turning to the door. He scanned his device and the door clicked open. Anna gave Roman a side eye as she pushed by him, opened the door, and led me inside. The palace remained unchanged. Members of the Haduni family had lived in the oversized home since the founding of Sassoon, each of them adding furniture, decorations, statues, paintings, and the like. The family that followed the last one soon found it to be in bad taste to remove the things their ancestors had hung up. It created an aura of a museum rather than a place to comfortably live. A living exhibit, kept spotlessly clean by an uneasing and constantly rotating janitorial staff.
I'll leave you to find your room. I trust you haven't forgotten where it is.
I think I'll be fine. I rolled my eyes at her. As much as I would like to catch up, I do need to wake up early for the exam.
Fine.
She folded her arms across her chest.
But tomorrow night you are going to tell me everything about Mars.
I yawned.
Okay, I promise.
I made my way upstairs and down the familiar hallways until I found my room. Another soldier stood in the hallway on a roving patrol. She gave a slight bow as I scanned my device and entered my bedroom. Like everything else in the house, it hadn't changed. It had not been abandoned, however, as someone was sure to leave out study material for the induction exam. I wouldn't need it. Unlike many other Imperial Army hopefuls, I had spent the last 4 years preparing every day for this exam, mentally and physically. For 10 hours a day, every day, at Tigranes the Great Prep, we studied Imperial military history, doctrine, and tactics. We took practice exams every night until test anxiety had been purged from our minds. The cadre ran us ragged and pushed our bodies until the standard physical agility test hardly made us break a sweat. Only the most prominent Imperial families could gain entrance into the school, of which the Haduni were not, no matter how much my father wished we were. Instead, he signed various lopsided trade deals with the Arshuni family of Mars in order for me to gain entry. The Haduni family's profile was bolstered by my attendance at such an important school, while the Arshuni would enjoy tax-free imports for such a long time, I'm sure it would only add to our family's growing debt problem. I stripped off my clothes that still smelled heavily of economy starway and crawled into my bed, slipping into a dreamless sleep. Chapter 2. Sassoon was too small to host a full-time Imperial Army recruiting office. Rather, they would swing by once per year to conduct the induction exam for whoever showed up at the local high school. It didn't matter if you were a noble or a citizen, you were to take the same test. Officer candidates simply had to score higher and pass something akin to a job interview with the recruiter at the end. It was always conducted by another noble. They weren't really judging you as much as your pedigree and if your family deserved to be elevated into the Army's corps of officers. Hopefuls from the surrounding stations and settlements too small for even a yearly visit from the recruiter all traveled to Sassoon in order to take the exam. As such, the area had become packed with human bodies of all shapes, sizes, and various regional accents. It was easy to tell who was here for the officer corps and who was there to enlist. Nobles were dressed in exercise uniforms from their local military academies where they had attended prep school. Others wore street clothes in different stages of disrepair. I noticed I was the only one there wearing the red tracksuit of Tigranes the Great Prep. A good sign for me. What branch of service you ended up in depended on your test scores. For the Army, the highest scores meant you could pick from infantry, armor, or artillery. If you scored high enough and had the right connections, you could even commission into the Navy. The thought had crossed my mind to buck family tradition and become a pilot, though my time trapped on the Starway told me that becoming a space jockey probably wasn't for me. Everyone stood around in small groups made up of people they had arrived at the high school with. They stayed in their little groups, nobody wanting to socialize with a stationer or planet sider until it was required. Eventually, a man dressed in Imperial Army blue emerged from the inside of the high school. He was a non-commissioned officer, a staff sergeant from the look of it. His chest was heavy with skill badges and awards, and his face showed deep-set wrinkles that tend to come on faster than normal with Imperial service.
"Listen up for your names," he called out.
He read off from a list of what seemed like hundreds of names. I was the only Haduni on the list, but I did hear three different Boguni be announced. They had much of the same traditions as we did, shuffling off the younger ones into Imperial service so they could learn the ins and outs of the shipping trade on someone else's dime, only to get folded into the family business cartel at the end of their 5-year stint. After everyone answered when their names were called out, the staff sergeant walked down the stairs and into the field where we were all gathered.
"We are going to do the physical agility course first. It weeds out which of you didn't even bother to prepare for this exam and gives the ones being pressured by their families an easy out."
He walked over to where another group of blue-uniformed soldiers stood. They were low-ranking soldiers that looked annoyed they had been ordered to be there.
"The first event is 2 minutes of push-ups. You will line up in front of one of these soldiers and they will count out each of your reps. If you fail, don't come crying to me. I'm not going to entertain your arguments about how many you did or how the person grading you couldn't count. It's a push-up, not rocket science."
We did as we were told. We stood in single-file lines without speaking, watching the person in front of us get down on the ground and do push-ups while the watching soldier loudly counted out the reps. I noticed a few of the people in front of me struggled after only doing a few, walking off with a defeated expression. When it was my turn, the soldier asked my name.
"Haduni,"
I answered. The bored-looking soldier glanced up from his device and motioned to the ground.
"After you, my lord."
I got down and began doing push-ups. I had done hundreds a day while in school, for both exercise and the occasional punishment when the cadre caught someone doing something unlawful. After all of that, there was no way I was going to do anything other than get the highest score I could. When I hit 100 and still had 30 seconds left, the soldier told me to stop. The score didn't go up any higher than that. After the push-up event, our ranks had thinned out somewhat. A dozen or so people had failed and been sent packing. They would have to wait a full year before trying again. The next event would be the pull-up. The soldiers had wheeled out collapsible pull-up bars, embedding them in the shallow synthetic dirt that made up the soccer pitch. Again, one at a time, we filed through. More people were struggling now. The accumulative fatigue of dozens of push-ups made the second event harder by design. The people who didn't train for it or weren't some natural athletic freaks simply wouldn't be able to do enough at this point. When it was my turn, I jumped up to the bar and began knocking them out. The bar was gnarled and bit into my hands the tighter I grabbed it. I had lost count of how many I had done, but the soldier stopped me when I hit 50. At Tigranes the Great Prep, the cadre had stood outside of the dining facility and watched as each student did a minimum of 5 pull-ups before being allowed inside to eat. With every semester of school that would pass, the number of required pull-ups would increase. This same rule was put in place in front of the library, dorms, and classrooms with different exercises. The goal was, by the time you graduated, the minimum of any exercise you would do would be the maximum score on the induction exam. Our number had dropped considerably by the third event, the hardest event of the physical portion of the induction exam, the run. We would be sent in 8 laps around the school track, totaling 3 miles. This event was easy to train for, but many people failed due to the location of their training. If they were a planet sider, the station air might hurt their lungs or be harder to breathe, and vice versa. I was about to find this out for myself, as I had not nearly enough time to reacclimate to Sassoon since I had arrived. When I began running, the station air, once so familiar, stung my lungs harshly. The Martian atmosphere felt strange to me the entire time I had been there because it was so clean and crisp. It was a natural, real space. Growing up on Sassoon meant that I had functionally lived in a human terrarium my entire life. Everything down to the air that I had breathed was synthetic. It took 4 years, but I eventually acclimated to Mars, something my body was constantly reminded of now that I was attempting to sprint 3 miles with mouthfuls of polluted and recycled station air. I coughed and sputtered as I went, still in the lead of the pack. The muscles in my legs began to burn with exertion while my lungs thirsted for clean air. I could hear the planet-siders behind me going through the same realization I was. I still forced myself to stay ahead of the acclimated stationers who were jogging without a care in the world as a matter of pride. I mercifully crossed the finish line at the 15-minute mark and collapsed into the too stiff synthetic grass of the soccer field. It took me several more minutes to catch my breath. I was thankful for a small cup of water that the soldier who was greeting me offered. It tasted like purification chemicals, but I didn't care. The sergeant running the physical portion of the exam let us all sit around on the field until we weren't panting or sweating profusely anymore. I was sure it wasn't out of kindness, but rather because nobody wanted to be locked in a classroom with 100 sweating bodies as they took a test. Before we were brought into the school, the sergeant ordered us to line up. We stood shoulder to shoulder in the middle of the field as a captain appeared from the inside of the school. Instead of wearing the blue of the Imperial Army, he was cloaked in brown, a member of the Imperial Gendarmes. He was old for a captain, probably in his mid-50s. He was bent slightly at the waist from a bad back, and he walked slowly toward us with his hands clasped behind him.
"Candidates, my name is Captain Vartan of the Imperial Gendarme Corps."
His voice crackled from a synthesizer, a grotesque implant stitched into his throat. It made his words sound like a cartoonish robot from a network drama.
"As you are all aware, you are about to take the Imperial Service's vocational aptitude battery portion of the induction exam."
He began to pace in front of us, eyeing us up and down with a bored look on his face.
"Millions of citizens take this test across the Empire every year, so it should come as no surprise when I tell you that some of these citizens decide to try to cheat on this test. I'm sure you can tell from my presence here today that we do not take cheating lightly."
I'm sure I wasn't the only person standing there that had heard stories about the gendarmes. Admittedly, my status as the Duke's son would allow me to get away with a lot. On more than one occasion growing up, Anna and I had talked our way out of legal repercussions. No low-ranking gendarme wanted to be the one who brought the Duke's children back to the district jail. This was different, though. Sending an officer, a noble, like Vartan, to threaten us told me that nothing was going to protect anyone if they were caught cheating. I wasn't going to be able to talk my way out of any suspicion like a kind of youthful indiscretion.
"The integrity of the Imperial Battery is protected under the National Security Act. This means we, the Gendarme Corps, are charged with using any means in order to protect it from being compromised. We take this duty very seriously. Because of this, we have used various means to suss out who exactly might be attempting to bring answers or cheating devices into the official testing room. Thankfully, for you, these means are all quick and painless."
Vartan spun on a heel, more brown-jacketed gendarmes appearing out of the school doors behind him.
"So, at this time, you are going to remove all of your clothing and leave it in front of you. After you are fully undressed, do not touch your belongings until we tell you."
He sighed, rolling his eyes.
"Or the people to your left and right."
I did as I was told. The communal living of prep school had made me very desensitized about my own nakedness. Shared showers and bedrooms meant you were forced to lose whatever shame you had very quickly. I piled my clothes in front of me and waited. Gendarmes slowly made their way down the line, searching our clothes and skin. Another man used a handheld scanner, quickly running it across our naked bodies. Citizens were allowed to have implants, and they were incredibly common the more money one tended to have. However, you had to get them removed before entering Imperial service. The service would supply you with whatever implants they wanted you to have. Nothing more, nothing less. Not to mention, it would have been too easy for someone to use their neural network implant to cheat on a test. Eventually, the gendarmes found someone. Their scanner beeped, and they yanked some skinny girl out of line. She was slammed to the ground, screaming and crying, placed in handcuffs, and carried off. Her clothes were left behind. I assumed wherever she was being taken came with its own uniform. A gendarme stood in front of me while another rifled through my clothes. The scanner was run over my head, and I felt the warmth of its rays penetrate my skull. After a few seconds, I was given permission to get dressed again, and I slipped back into my still sweat-soaked tracksuit. Before they were done, the gendarmes had found another suspect, a thickly built planetsider. He had the bright idea of scribbling a series of small notes all over his body, which were clear as day once he had taken off his clothes. Much like the girl, he was dragged away, kicking and screaming. Once the search was over, we were led inside the school. The doors were locked behind us, and the gendarmes stayed behind. The Sassoon Central High School was not where I had gone. The children of the administration district had our own school. The Haik Haduni School was staffed by the best teachers on the station, and the student body was made up exclusively of the nobility. The district spared no expense giving us the best educational experience on Sassoon. That had not been the case here at Central. The hallways were run down, the false ceiling was missing squares, and the linoleum floor was cracked and scuffed. It looked like the school was almost in as bad of a need of renovation as the disembarkation area I had arrived in. We were led into a classroom and locked inside. We all took our seats behind simple wooden desks, each with a sealed package sitting on top of it. The sergeant reappeared, and deep down inside, I was happy that Captain Vartan was not locked in the room with us, though I was sure he was waiting just outside.
In front of you, you will find your copy of the test and a sealed pencil. When I say, open your packet and begin the test. You will not be allowed to use the bathroom, ask any questions, or talk to one another until you have completed your test and have left the room. Any deviation from these rules will lead to immediate failure, and if you're really unlucky, detention by the gendarmes until they decide what to do with you. Now, open your packet and begin.
I tore open the paper packet and found my test book. It was hundreds of pages long and came with a sharpened pencil taped to the top. I tore the pencil off, opened the book, and got to work. I did my best not to glance up at the clock to track how much time had passed. As I worked through the questions, pages blended together. The questions were a scattershot of history, political science, and general military knowledge in no particular order. In what year was Tigranes the Great's campaign against the Drani of Titan? What model of destroyer is considered standard for the Imperial Navy? Explain each rank in the Imperial Army between private and major general. It took me about halfway through the book before I found a question that gave me pause. An essay question that demanded an in-depth explanation of the failures of the Imperial Frontier Corps during the Battle of New Beginnings. It took me the better part of an hour to craft a two-paragraph answer that I thought made any sense. I decided that was good enough and moved on. By the time I got to the last page of the book, I was confident that I had done well. Looking at the people around me, their faces driven into the palms of their hands, some were crying. I was clearly feeling better than most. I had never failed any of the practice exams in prep school and always scored within the top 20% in my class. I raised my hand and the sergeant approached.
I said there were no questions, he grumbled.
No, Sergeant, I don't have a question. I'm done with my test.
The look on his face told me I was the first person to finish. I tried not to pay attention to anyone else so as not to be distracted. He raised an eyebrow at me.
Are you sure?
I nodded, and he grabbed my book from me. He motioned to the soldier at the door to move aside and let me out. I felt the eyes of the rest of the struggling test takers follow me as I made my way out. Soldiers and gendarmes stood bored in the hallways, distracted and playing games or videos on their devices. One of them noticed me and stuffed his device in his pocket.
If you failed, you can just go home, he said.
I just finished,
I corrected.
Oh, well, I'll be damned. Follow me then.
The soldier led me deeper into the school, eventually taking me to a waiting area. Seats lined the walls on both sides of a hallway. So far, they were all empty.
Have a seat. Someone will call for you in a bit. I'm going to judge from your tracksuit, you know what comes next.
He pointed to the crest of the school on my chest. I nodded.
You shouldn't have anything to worry about, but just mind your manners. I've heard the noble they sent out to conduct the interviews this time is kind of a hard ass. Thank you. Any idea what family he is from? I haven't seen him. I've heard he's a stationer, though.
With that, the soldier turned around and walked away. I took a seat in the empty hallway, but I wasn't left there for long. A nearby door opened and a soldier stuck her head out.
Haduni Andranik?
She asked.
Yes, ma'am,
I answered. She waved me toward the door.
Please come in and have a seat. The major will be here in a moment.
She led me into an office that appeared to be a repurposed teacher's lounge of some kind. Before I could sit, the door opened again and a man entered. Like the soldier said, he was a stationer. A tall, lanky man with the telltale orange-tinted skin of life under the artificial sun of our day cycles. He sat down behind a desk and began typing on a device, my face appearing in a blue hologram next to him.
Sit,
he croaked. I pulled a chair in front of his desk and sat down. When I finally got a look at his face, I realized he looked familiar. It wasn't uncommon for lifelong stationers to all look somewhat alike. There were only so many families who called the stations home, and they tended to marry into one another.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.